This week on Jerusalem Dateline, Israel celebrates its independence and remembers its dead. We look back on how Israel became a state and why many believe it's a modern-day miracle. Plus, see how biblical prophecy was fulfilled when the Jewish people returned to the land of Israel, and why a world-famous cartoonist looked to the Bible to find a name for his cartoons. Hello and welcome to this edition of Jerusalem Dateline. I'm Chris Mitchell. This week, Israelis celebrated Independence Day, their July 4th. That day took place in the middle of the 20th century, and it changed the world. We went to the heart of Tel Aviv, where it all began.
Al hakamat medina yehudit be'eretz Yisrael, hi medinat Yisrael.
Here in Independence Hall on May 14, 1948, David Ben-Gurion declared the formation of the State of Israel. For the first time in nearly 2,000 years, the Jewish people were a nation once again.
This is where Israel was born. When people come here, they are astonished to see this place. Most of the people that visit here, their first reaction is, this is it? That's all you have here?
Ben-Gurion and his team looked for an inconspicuous place to declare statehood. At the time, Independence Hall, one of the first buildings in Tel Aviv, was an art gallery. During a 1978 renovation, the decision was made to take the building back to its original look at the time of the declaration.
Traveling in Israel will teach you that God has a tendency to perform his best miracles in the most humble places. This place is one of those places.
According to Isaac Dror, who heads education at the Hall, the establishment of Israel shook the world and became a haven for the Jewish people.
How many people prayed for it every day when the Jews said, next year in Jerusalem and next year in Jerusalem? That's what they meant.
When Israel declared its independence, dancing filled the streets. But the celebration was short-lived. The very next day, armies of five Arab nations invaded the newborn state.
When it comes to the story of the War of Independence, we don't have many answers there. Very hard for us to explain. Call it a miracle, call it whatever you want, but we are here.
130,000 people visit this tiny hall each year to hear about the miracle of Israel, including tourists like this group from Massachusetts.
I didn't expect it to be so moving. My whole life, Israel has always been here. So I think in some ways took it for granted. And now I, you know, felt like I was here that day.
After 2,000 years of wandering and persecution, for Jews to have their own state really has to be a miracle.
Across the street is this monument with a scripture from Jeremiah. Again I will build you, and you shall be rebuilt, O Virgin of Israel. Surrounded by skyscrapers and a new generation visiting the hall, it's testament to God's faithfulness to his promise to build and rebuild the Jewish state and its people. Even before Ben-Gurion declared the State of Israel in 1948, in 1922, the world powers met in a small Italian town on the Mediterranean called San Remo. What they decided then set the stage for Israel's rebirth. Former Israeli President Chaim Weizmann said, this picturesque town on the Mediterranean played a crucial role in Israel's modern history.
He said that it's not an exaggeration to say that the Jewish state was born in San Remo.
Following the defeat of the Ottoman Empire in World War I, leaders of the Allied powers met in San Remo. Their goal? A new Middle East. While most of the land went to the Arab people, the Jewish people received back their ancient homeland.
What is very important to understand is that long before that, long before the Holocaust, there was already an agreement that the Jewish people had a right to statehood, they had a right to self-determination, just like any other people groups.
Israel also recognizes San Remo as a present-day foundation in its battle for a place among the nations.
Since there is an effort today to question our legitimacy, we have to go back to San Remo and say, look, here is the international document agreed by all members of the League of Nations at the time that says that, yes, we have this right.
And that right provides historical ammunition to fight the boycott, divestment, and sanctions movement called BDS. It aims to persuade companies and countries to withdraw money and investments from Israel.
It counters the arguments of the BDS movement to say that, you know, Israel is a colonial power. It is the opposite. Many historians would say that the San Remo resolution also was the beginning of the decolonization process, because here we have a people group that have been occupied for 1,800 years about, that are finally getting their recognition of statehood.
Sandel adds anyone questioning the modern state of Israel can find the answer in this Italian connection.
When we today have this whole question of, do the Jewish people really belong in Israel? Do they have a legitimate claim to the land? That question was decided once and for all in 1920 under international law here at this very place, San Remo.
After its founding, the Jewish state achieved advances in a number of different fields. Gordon Robertson brings us the story about how Israel has become a world leader in technology.
Israel has often been called the startup nation. And while Jerusalem may be the spiritual heart of the country, Tel Aviv is the center of its startup success. Just a century ago, this thriving city was little more than a series of sand dunes. Today, it's been voted the second best high-tech center in the world.
From the iPhone to the PlayStation, many of the ideas behind your favorite gadgets came from inventors right here in Israel.
Flip-top cell phones, keyboards for smartphones, Intel Pentium chips, the ability to print straight from your computer, the flash drive, the chip in the iPad, the OS that runs the Amazon Kindle, the chip that controls the Sony PlayStation, and the 3D sensor in the Xbox Kinect. Every year, American companies are shelling out more and more shekels to buy small Israeli startups.
I think the key challenge for Israeli companies now is to go from startup nation to scale-up nation. We need to build bigger companies, not just sell them early to American multinationals, but to actually get them bigger, to get them into the sales process, and to create more jobs both here and in America and around the world.
So what gives Israel its technological edge?
Chutzpah is perhaps the most definitive Jewish word. Very, very hard to translate. Gall, unrelenting daring. That chutzpah is what allows us to actually break the boundaries and to break the rules and to go out of our comfort zone in order to create new things.
That culture of challenging and debating and arguing, it's everywhere in Israel. Arguing is healthy because you get to better answers, you get to better results. And I think that is a key cultural attribute in Israel's economic success story and its economic miracle.
And I believe this tradition, this culture, it's a part of our DNA.
If you all think alike, you all act alike, I'm sorry, it's not going to be a particularly creative place.
I always say that the secret source of the Israeli high-tech is the Jewish mother who asked her son at the age of 7, after all what we have done for you, asking you for one Nobel Prize, is it really too much?
Yossi Vardi is known as the godfather of Israel's high-tech industry. He's invested in more than 80 internet startups, including a company started by his son. That unbelievable product was ICQ, the world's first instant messaging service. Less than a year later, America Online bought the company for $400 million.
In most job interviews here, the big question isn't where you went to college, but where you served in the military.
In Israel, almost every single Israeli serves in the military. Almost every single Israeli is put through this training in how to lead, how to manage, how to make very difficult decisions with very little information under enormous pressure. And these skills hardwire young people for being entrepreneurs.
Many Israeli IT companies are founded by alumni of an elite military intelligence unit known as 8200, a highly secretive group that specializes in cyber warfare. Unit 8200 is believed to be the brains behind the Stuxnet virus that targeted Iran's nuclear facilities. Israelis are proud to say that many of their high-tech ideas come from their experience in the army. An idea some say could also benefit American companies.
American businesses have a lot to learn with how Israel has integrated their military people when they're coming out of the military into the economy.
If you'd like to see the entire Made in Israel series, you can go to our website at cbn.com and click on Made in Israel. Up next, a look back on how Israel's Air Force got its wings. Welcome back. While Israel now boasts one of the strongest militaries in the world, when the state was born, they barely had an army or an air force. Nancy Spielberg, sister of Steven Spielberg, produced a documentary on how the fledgling Air Force got off the ground. Here's a look.
I was in Minot, North Dakota, partners in a used car and truck business. Money, girlfriends, cars, the whole enchilada. When I got this phone call from New York.
I got a letter from a friend of mine at TWA, called this number and asked for Swifty, just like that. So what the hell, I called the number. Livingston, where the hell are you? We've been waiting a week for you. I said, waiting for me? Huh? Yeah, we need you right away.
I said I'd wear a flying jacket, so a leather jacket, so they would recognize me. And they said to bring a logbook of proof that I was a pilot.
The meeting at a hotel on 57th Street, New York, the Henry Hudson Hotel, served great martinis.
A fellow who identified himself as Steve Schwartz, apprising me of the fact that Israel was going to declare itself a state, that they were going to be attacked by at least five Arab armies, and they had no way to defend themselves, except that they had purchased some airplanes, but they had no one to fly them. And would I be in a position to help?
The idea that Jews were going to fight, I found exciting. It's about time.
It wasn't like a newspaper ad joined the Haganah. It was illegal, of course.
And I had just made up my mind that nothing was going to stop me.
The alternative is too hard for me to envision, the possibility of what the Arabs could have done. And they talked about the fact that what Hitler did will be nothing compared to what we're going to do. 600,000 Jews and 50 million Arabs surrounding them, I didn't see how they could possibly survive. The Arabs had squadrons, they had planes, they had tanks, they had guns, they had everything.
If you don't go now, they'll be in Tel Aviv in the morning and there's no Israel.
These airplanes had never been test flown. They were assembled in the hangar and they just started up, taxed out and attacked the Egyptian army coming up the coast.
I saw the enemy that came to destroy us. I just did a quick Shema Yisrael, even though I'm not religious. Turned the airplane upside down because the dive bomb, the steeper the dive, the more accurate is the hit.
They stopped the Egyptians cold.
As a Jew, I now felt proud of being Jewish.
I was born to be here in that moment of history to contribute to Israel's survival.
I had done something good for once.
We built an air force. We started an air force.
If you wrote the history of the Jewish people 1,000 years from now, there are two things that I can tell you will be in it. One is the Holocaust, one is the birth of the State of Israel.
Shortly before I left, I happened to be in Tel Aviv when they were bringing in refugees from the death camps in Europe. I remember them getting down on their hands and knees and kissing the ground. I knew then and there that was the reason that I came.
Coming up, see how biblical prophecy was fulfilled when the Jewish people returned to the land of Israel. Welcome back. Since its founding, Israel has faced dangers on most every side. Despite those dangers, many see God fulfilling His promises to the Jewish people and biblical prophecy coming to pass. Here's Julie Stahl.
In the Bible, God promises the Jewish people a land flowing with milk and honey. And while it's a sign of abundance, it's also literal.
In fact, milk and honey is critical. It's used 20 times in Scripture.
But when the Jewish people returned from 2,000 years in exile, they found a barren desert land. And Orthodox Jewish author Moshe Kempinski says that was all in God's plan.
God says, I'm going to do something miraculous. I'm going to create a land that even though those climate issues don't call for it, it's going to be a land that's going to be filled also with dates and honey and also with milk, so that you know that nothing comes here. Nothing in this land comes here except when it's from me.
And God has delivered on that promise.
We consider leaders in that production of milk in the world.
Despite the heat, humidity, and limited resources, the Israeli cow produces more milk per year than cows in the U.S., European Union, and Australia.
We keep going up.
Ronen Gal manages operations for the dairy at Kibbutz Yotvata, the largest milking facility of its kind in the country.
The milk production in Israel is very clever. It's very high-tech.
And what about the honey? Most believe honey in Bible times probably came from date trees. Botanist Dr. Elaine Salloway emigrated from the U.S. and settled not far from Yotvata on Kibbutz Keturah in 1974.
Actually, I started out here as the head of the orchard branch. And of course, that was kind of funny because at that time we didn't have any orchards. So in the first few years, I was responsible for planting them. And the first orchard I planted was the date orchard, which you can see behind us, which is the main agricultural branch of the kibbutz.
There are tens of thousands of acres of date trees in Israel. Salloway planted some 3,000 of those trees here. This date orchard is here at Kibbutz Keturah in the Arava Desert. Each one of these trees produces about 350 pounds of dates a year. Salloway even managed to sprout a 2,000-year-old date seed found by archaeologists years ago at Masada. Nicknamed Methuselah, the tree is now 5 years old. Dates and palms were important in the scriptures, and dates from this area were known throughout the ancient world.
The Romans had nothing nice to say about the Jews, except that they had good dates. And their emperors actually used to order Judean dates to eat. And there were some very, very good date varieties in that day. They were famous through the known world.
Today, Israel's dates are still famous throughout the world. Israel exports some 12,000 tons of dates each year to 20 countries. Now, Salloway is going beyond dates to grow other life in the desert.
I'm looking for trees that love to live in the desert, that rejoice to live in the desert, not the ones I have to keep on life support.
She found clues in the Bible.
Well, the biblical trees, if they grew here in the old days, why shouldn't they grow here now? We reintroduced frankincense and myrrh, which had probably been introduced at the time of King Solomon. According to what we can tell from folk tales and from the Bible, there was already an incense and a medicinal tree being cultivated here called the Balm of Gilead.
The frankincense and myrrh brought to Jesus were probably in crystal form like this. According to Kempinski, the revival of trees in the land is the first sign of redemption.
Ezekiel 36 says, mountains, shoot forth your branches, give forth your fruit, because my children are coming home. That's an unusual thing for God to tell a tree. That's what He created a tree to do. Except God is saying in Leviticus, I said it's going to be a desolate land when I kick you out. But watch, when I bring my people back home, this land is going to come forth with blossoms and trees and fruits.
So He says, every date you eat and every glass of milk you drink here is like prophecy being fulfilled. Julie Stahl, CBN News, Kibbutz Keturah, Israel.
Up next, see how this world-famous cartoonist gave his cartoon strips its unique name. Dry Bones is one of the most well-known cartoons in the world. It's read by millions. And the creative genius behind the cartoon, Yaakov Kershon, explains how he came up with the unusual name for his work.
When I came to Israel and decided I would start doing a cartoon, I thought, well, I needed a name, like Kershon's Corner, with corner spelt with a K. And I kept thinking, what should it be? And then I realized that one of the things that had brought me to Israel was my reading of the book of Ezekiel. And in the book of Ezekiel, this guy Ezekiel, who lived 2,600 years ago, saw a vision of what to him was the far future. And that was of a time when it looked like the world had destroyed the Jewish people. But at that point, we would come out of our graves, and the image he saw was of a valley filled with dry bones. And these bones came together, like the knee bone connected to the shin bone and all like that. And in that imagery, he saw the rebuilding of the Jewish state. He saw the coming together and the ingathering of the Jewish people. He saw the rebuilding of the cities and the planting of the trees. And therefore, if I was going to do a cartoon about what was happening today, all I could do would be to add to what he had seen incredibly 2,600 years ago. And so I decided to call it Dry Bones, thinking that everyone would understand.
From the dry bones in the book of Ezekiel to the declaration by David Ben-Gurion, many see Israel as a modern-day miracle and a sign to the nations that God fulfills his promises. Well, that's it for this edition. For more news, please follow us on Twitter or Facebook. I'm Chris Mitchell. We'll see you next time on Jerusalem Dateline.